Why is training about private investigations, and specifically just having a solid high knowledge level of private investigations, important in our line of work? Hi, this is Larry Kay with ShadowAnyone.com and the creator of the Investigator's Ultimate Guide series, which is premium private investigator training from someone who's been there and done that. This is one of those weird things, right? When a guy who's selling training is going to debate or talk about is training important or not, or why is it important? Look, the question of is it important or not, I think we all know training's important. You've got to know what you're doing in this line of work. Today, what I want to talk about is just why and what level and when do you know enough that you really know enough to do the job. Certainly, your training, your learning, your experience is going to continue the entire time you're in this profession. Things are always changing. Especially, let's look, if you do social media skip tracing, if you do any investigations that touch upon social media, that stuff is changing all the time. Every 6 months, one platform or another is going to change the amount of information they archive, or how you search it, or if you can search it or not. This is just a constant thing you have to keep up on. But let's just talk about getting into this line of work. How much do you need to know? When do you have that knowledge level that covers what you need to do in order to be successful, in order to serve your clients? I want to look at two scenarios of someone having to get into a house. The first scenario is a burglar. Now, a burglar who wants to get into a house obviously is going to look around in that house and steal things. But imagine for a moment what this looks like from the burglar's perspective. He can drive down the street. He can see a house and say, you know what? That clearly has an alarm system. I don't want to mess with that house. Drive down another one. I see a dog in there. I don't want to mess with that. Past another house, there are cars in the driveway. I really don't want someone to be home when I'm going in. Down until he finds a house that looks like there's nobody in there. It looks like an easy target. He can park. He can walk up and knock on the front door. If someone answers the door, he can pretend like, oh, I'm lost. My car broke down or I'm having trouble, and leave and not do anything. But if no one answers the door, he'll go around back, knock on the door again, kick it in, and be in the house. Compare that to how a private investigator has to get into a house. Now imagine for a moment that you're working on a child custody case and someone's concerned about that there's drugs in the house, drug dealing, maybe that it's an unsafe environment. Many times this type of investigation will be held covered by child social services, you know, a government or quasi-government organization. Many times a guardian ad litem, someone will be appointed by the court to go in and investigate and document. But sometimes a private investigator is going to be hired to get access to the house to see what the environment looks like. Now, the private investigator doesn't have the luxury of being able to wait till no one's home and break in. Clearly, private investigators are not allowed to break the law, not any of the laws. And in fact, when you're licensed, you find you have a lot more regulations that you have to follow as far as maybe just administrative things like keeping workers' comp on your workers and registering your workers with the state, that type of thing. But we have to definitely keep it within the law. Essentially, in a case like that, a private investigator needs to be invited into the house by someone who's authorized to invite people into the house. Much more tricky than the burglar situation. We don't get to choose which house looks easiest. We don't get to drive around until we find something that seems like it'll work for us. We have a specific house, a specific place we need to get into. We have to get in kind of a specific way as to be invited in to look around. And this is the type of thing that does happen. I don't know how much you might pick up cases like this. It really just depends. When I was doing this regularly, I kind of had to take a variety of cases from different attorneys, from different clients. So I would work workers' comp cases, I'd work domestic cases, and just all sorts of things. And this is the type of thing that I was occasionally called on to do. So how good do you have to be to get invited into that house? You have to be way better than the burglar, right? You have to have a real much higher skill set than somebody who's got all of these chances and all these breaks. And if you blow it, if you make a mistake, you don't get to just knock on the door like a burglar, somebody's there, I wasn't planning on that, and walk and say I'm lost and walk away. If you blow the opportunity to get in there, no one else is going to be able to pretext their way into that house, right? You have really stopped the case stone cold right there. So how much do you need to know? How much is training going to play a part in this? You need to know enough to be good enough to do the job. I can't put a number on it, a 1 to 10. You got to be at least a 7. You got to be at an 8. You've got to be good enough to do the job, do it well and legally. And then the stuff we talk about here may seem like the exciting or the fun or the glamorous parts, but afterwards, there is documenting, there's reporting, there may be testifying in court, a lot of the unglamorous drudgery of the job that you have to be good at as well. So this is where the importance of knowledge and training come in before you get the case, before you need to get into that house. And so whatever area you're looking to learn about or know, whether it's skip tracing, read all the books you can find on skip tracing. You're going to find where the information starts to overlap time and time again, and you'll read an entire book on skip tracing only to pull out literally one or two sentences somewhere in the middle of the book with a new idea or a new thought that now you put that tool in your tool bag and you have access to it. When you're learning about surveillance, read what you can about surveillance, learn what you can about surveillance. Obviously, I've got a course on it. Same with process serving. Process serving is one of those things that you do essentially the same thing over and over again. You're delivering papers to people. And most of the time, it's going to be very vanilla. You are just delivering papers. People are going to be very civil about it. They're going to be very polite about it. But you're going to come across times where you need to serve someone who's hiding in a house, somebody who only comes out to go to work. How are you going to serve somebody who doesn't even have a job? When do they come out of their house? All of these types of things, these variations, and the more tools and tricks and things you learn from training, the better equipped you are to handle the situations when they come up. Obviously, training's important. Get it from someplace credible. If not from me, at least be reading the books. At least be going to the library, or, you know, online shopping now is so affordable and easy. I love to support local bookshops, but if you got nothing else going for you, buy some books online and read them and learn from them. But you gotta develop your skills and have those skills in place for when you need them. This is Larry K with ShadowAnyone.com. Remember, do the right thing, even if it's the hard thing.